I'm Greg Brown, and I'm the media director here at the Place of Grace, Praise Temple Biloxi. I'm excited about a new sermon series called Okay, Okay, What's Next? So I want to give you direct access to the sermon. Take some notes, tell a friend, share this video as I introduce our lead pastor, Pastor Pickett. Thank you.
Chapter 17, verse 1 through 4, reads, "And Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, 'As the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain in these next years except at my word.' Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, 'Get away from here.' Then the words of the Lord came to him, saying, 'Get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook of Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. And it will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there.'" He tells Elijah, "Get from here and go to there." This month, we're opening up a new sermon series entitled, Okay, Okay, What's Next? This morning, I want to use as a topic, from here to there. This month, as we open up this sermon series, it's my desire to take somebody by the hand and run them into their next season of their life. You've been stagnant long enough. You've been wondering long enough. You've been doubting long enough. And it's my desire, Sister Tawana, to grab you by the hand and run you into your next. Notice I didn't say push you, because I want to run you along into your next. Because sometimes, Mr. Wendell, we can be pushed and we'll still pause. But if I run you, it's my momentum that will carry you. That's why, Sister Yolanda, in this season, this month, partnership is so important. Because as I'm running along, I need somebody to run along with me. Have you ever asked yourself the question, what does life have for me next? It's not rhetorical. I want you to really think about that. Have you ever asked yourself, what does life have for me next? Have you ever been in a place where you felt that there was something more for you, but you just couldn't put your hands on it? You felt like that there was more for you, but you just didn't know what it was. That's how I ended up here in ministry, because I was doing something at the time and I was working in ministry, but it was something much more God had for me. Have you ever felt that there was something more, but you just couldn't touch it? Have you ever felt like you were ever in a place where you needed more? God, I just need more. If I don't get more, then I don't know what I'm going to do with myself. Hey, have you ever been in that place to where you just felt like you were thirsty for more of something, but you just didn't know what it is? We've all heard it said that life is a journey. Life is a journey. And this stage in my life, as I've gotten older, I believe that life is truly a journey. But I also believe, because I've seen it happen in my life, that it's a journey that's full of obstacles. So it's not a straight journey. It's a journey that's full of obstacles that has twists and turns. It's not a straight path to success. It's not a straight path, amen, on this journey. But there are some things, EJ, that happens in our life that makes us wonder, man, am I really supposed to be right here in this place? Things happen. Things happen on the journey, Brother Reggie, that we never even prepared for because we thought the journey was going to be one way. And then somewhere along the journey, there was a derailment in our lives. There was a derailment in our lives. And we now like, man, I want to quit because the journey that I was on, Miss Jan, amen, is full of hurt. It's full of harm. It's full of danger. There are obstacles. There are setbacks. There are twists. There are turns. There are pitfalls on this journey. And sometimes the journey makes us want to quit because the journey has a lot of bumps. It has a lot of bruises. It has a lot of headache. The journey has a lot of pain. But I believe that if we just keep walking, I believe that if we just keep trusting, one day we will understand that the journey was worth it. Why do I say that? Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, he says, "For I consider the suffering of this present time is not worthy to be compared for the glory which will be revealed within us." I mean, you may be going through something right now on this journey, but I believe that if you keep on going, you will see something that will manifest itself in your life that will tell you it was worth the bumps. It was worth the bruises. It was worth the obstacles. It was worth the twists and turns. Somebody say it was worth the losses. Because there are some things in our life that we didn't want to lose, amen. There are some things in our life that we cried about losing, but there are some things in our life that couldn't go on a journey with us. There are some things that was going on in our life that couldn't go on a journey with us, because if it had went on a journey with us, amen, it would have made the journey even more stressful. And if you look back on your life right now, some things that you have learned on this journey, some things that you have lost on this journey, some things that have detached itself away from you on this journey, if you would have been bought them on this journey, about it on this journey right now, you will probably not be where you are on this journey. Somebody say, some stuff you got to let go. The journey ain't for everything. The journey ain't for everything. It's a time and a season. Ecclesiastes says, for everything. And some stuff gotta go. Some stuff can't tag along with you, amen. Even though when you lost it, it hurt you. Even though when you hit it, it hurt you. Amen. Even though when it hits you, it hurt you, amen. Some stuff can't go. American poet Ralph Waldo Emerson coined the phrase, life is a journey, not a destination. This is what I want to get to us today, that life is a journey, not a destination. This phrase is powerful because it gives us an understanding that like a journey, life is ongoing. Life is ongoing. Life is ongoing, unlike a destination, which has an arrival point and an end point. The way many of us have been living, we've been living life as a destination. We only want to get so far and then we stop. We only want to get to one place and then we stop, not understanding that stopping defaults your destiny. Stopping defaults your destiny, amen. Stopping don't allow you to see what God has for you in the end. And many of us have been living, God, if I can just get to this point, I'm going to be all right. Many of our prayers, Lord, if you just get me through this, I'm okay. No, but we have to ask God, God, when you get me through this, what's next? Because it's so much more before us than where we are at now. It's so much more before us than what we're going through. And if we just ask God, God, get me through this to a place of comfort and I'm good, then guess what? We will default destiny. You can't default destiny. You can't default destiny. And it's important to understand that we have to stop God asking God when. When is this going to happen? When is that going to happen? Because now what we're telling God is, God, I'm only looking for that. We're not asking God, God, what's next? What's to come? What's down the road? God, what am I supposed to maneuver when you get me through this? When, says God, we're asking God for an arrival time. But life has no stopping point. Life has no stopping point, even though it may be full of accomplishments, even though life may be full of victories, amen. Life may be full of moments where you can say that this is it. This is my aha moment. This is my right now moment. Even though life has all of that, you must keep in mind that there is more to your destiny. Tiffany, I know you accomplished your lifelong goal in education to have your master's in accounting, but there is so much more. What's next? Vicky, I know one of the things that you wanted to do is be an RN and you accomplished that, but what's next? I know there are so many other people who have set goals and put your mind to some things, but now you have settled into a place of comfort and you have stopped asking God, what's next? God, I'm here. Where do I go from here? From here, God is saying this morning, you have to go from here to there. There should never be a moment in your life when you said, I'm done. There is nothing else for me to do. I've accomplished everything that it was for me to accomplish. Because at that moment you say that, that's the moment you stop living. That's the moment you stop living. The moment you said, I've done everything I can. Mr. Bill, I'm happy birthday today. But Mr. Bill, there is so much more for you to do. Because the moment you said, ha-ha, I've made it to that place. That's the moment where you begin to your decline. That's the moment you begin your descent. And as children of God, it's important for us to understand that as long as we have breath in our life, God has a purpose for our lives. God has a purpose for our life. Reggie, Altamisa, I know you guys are launching a new thing in your life, but could there be more that goes along with that? I don't see one truck. I see fleets of trucks. Watch me. Notice I said, I see what? Fleets of truck, which means I just don't see a parking lot full of in Biloxi. Come on. I see what? Fleets. Come on. Could it be a possibility that there's a station in Houston? Could it be a possibility that there's a station in Lafayette? Could it be a possibility, amen, that what's the possibility? See, we got to understand that God is not limited to our imagination. But our imagination puts a mandate on God. God is not limited to by what we can see, but what? Watch this. What we can see put a mandate on God. So God is not limited to a fleet here in Biloxi. God is not limited here to a fleet in Houston. Watch this. God is not limited to a fleet in Lafayette. Watch this. But what I just did is put a mandate on God. Because God is not limited to three locations, amen. But I just say, God, you're subjected to giving them at least three. If you can see it. If you can see it, come on, you got to be able to say, God, there has to be more to this. There has to be more to this. Why do I say this? Look, can we look at some Bible? Why do I say this? Because God is subjected to movement. God is subjected to movement. Somebody say movement. See, God is not subjected to stagnation. God is not subjected to us sitting right here in a place to where we are. See, some of us may be happy with this little part of the parking lot, but I ain't happy until we get the whole parking lot. Actually, can we have a restaurant? See. Actually, can we have the whole block? Amen. Even the coffee shop that they just built, because I'm not subject to just sitting here. If don't nobody else want to come, I take it. Y'all too quiet for me. Y'all saying he greedy. Okay. I just serve a great God. Greedy and great goes together. Yes. It's almost spelled the same. Catch that tomorrow. Watch this. Ever since God breathed breath into the body of man, God has been positioning man. Ever since he breathed breath into the body of man, he has been positioning the man. Remember, I said God operates in what? Movement. And ever since God blew his breath into Adam, he has been moving man. Watch this. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 8, that after blowing breath into man and giving him life, he creates a garden and puts man in it. He creates a garden and puts man in it. God could have called Adam, amen, and told Adam to do exactly what he wanted to do right there in that position he was in. Because God blew his spirit, he could have dictated life for Adam right there in that place. But no, God created a garden for Adam, amen, put everything in the garden that Adam needed to survive. And God put Adam over there and say, take care of all of this. Now, if you look at the garden has rivers flowing through it, amen. So that tells me it's not a little 10 by 10 garden, amen. It's a place of operation, amen, that Adam can do what God has sent him to do. See, it's rivers flowing through it. So it's not the garden in your backyard. Come on. It's not the above the ground garden. Come on. What God said, I created an entire world. I created an entire universe for Adam to operate in it and get what he wants in it. So God creates man and allows man, gives man the thing that causes him to function. He positions him. Watch this. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 14, after God sees wickedness over the face of the earth, God says, Noah, there's wickedness in all mankind. However, I'm going to use you to restore the earth because I'm going to wipe it out. What did God tell Noah to do? Build an ark. He builds him a place that's going to allow him to reposition himself. He's going to build an ark, and Noah's going to get in the ark, him and his family. He's going to bring these animals in the ark. And he says, and he tells Noah, he says, watch this. I'm ridding the world of his wickedness, but I'm going to give you a place of movement. I'm going to give you a place of movement, a place to where you can go from where? Here to there. You got to leave here because this place, amen, is not fit for your growth. This place is not conducive for your growth, amen. Watch this. Wickedness is a mindset. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, God decides to bless Adam, amen, bless Abram, who's become known as the father of faith. But before blessing him, he tells him this, leave. Leave this place of thinking. And go to a place that I'm going to show you that's going to change your thinking. See, we got to understand that sometimes God, we're looking at God to take us from one location in the physical to another location, but it's not where you at, because you can take that same mindset to a new location and be the same person. You got to change your mindset in the way you're thinking. So if going from here to there is not about movement, amen, in your place, but it's about movement in your mind. You've been thinking the same way too long. Come on, some of us have been thinking the same way through too long, and we're wondering why hadn't nothing happened in our life. Nothing happened in our life, Ms. Jan, is because of the way we think. Going from here to there is about mindset. How were they young scounds and now they old scounds? Thinking the same way. You gotta be willing to change your mindset. Could the problem be not the environment, but the problem is your mind? Could the problem not be the environment, but the problem be your mind? The way you think? Watch this. Abram couldn't stay there because he would only see what he got. God had to move him so he can see what he could have. Noah, watch this. God could have built him a platform, but he would have still have saw the depth that he had there. You got to be willing to change your mindset. Watch this. After Jesus' resurrection in Matthew 28:18-20, he tells us, go into the world, make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things that I've commanded you. He's saying, go in there and teach them how to change their minds. Because, Yolanda, you can be in a place of destiny and your mind does not see your future. Of destiny, and many have forfeited destiny
because they refused to see differently. They refused to see differently. Watch this. You got to have room to grow.
Spiritually, mentally, emotionally, you got to have, there's always room to grow.
So I was thinking this thought the other day. How do we as people become so comfortable with the positions that we find ourselves in? How do we become so comfortable with the positions? Anybody happy where they at right now? I mean, you good right there. Right where you at right now, you good. You good. Anybody? Huh? Mr. Bill, you probably retired. Yeah, you're doing fairly well for yourself. You got a couple retirements under your belt at that. He played golf every day. It was whispered over here. He played golf every day. But you probably can't go and come as you please. Can't go. Do you want to go and come as you please? Not really. Not really. Oh, I do. I just want to be able to just grab that suitcase and be like, let's go. Yeah, I'm talking about just fly. I mean, now you got to put some boundaries. Like, you got to have some rest. But you just want to be able to just jump on a jet plane whenever, right? No, I don't really feel like being bothered with the coast. Just want to go. But you're not, yeah, that. So that tells me that there's room to grow. Miss Jan, and you really can't do that because Miss Jan's still working, you know. So there's room to go. He said, I can still go. But you got to come back, amen. But there is room to grow is the point that I'm trying to get. And he's the one with the retirements over here, amen. But there's still room for him to grow. There's still room for him to grow. And I was thinking that the reason why we don't grow is because we get comfortable with here and forget that there's a there. So we stop looking, we stop searching, we stop receiving, we stop growing, we stop becoming knowledgeable, we stop gaining wisdom, we stop gaining insight, because what we do right now, we're happy with. We're happy with. And when you get in a place of being happy with, you will never get anything added to you that belongs to you, because you're currently happy with that. And what belongs to you, amen, is not able to fit in that box that you have created for yourself. We believe as Christians that once we're saved by the blood of Jesus, that all of our issues are handled. And we allow God to start moving and stop moving in our life. And that's why we're happy for a little while with church. We're comfortable for a moment with church, because we believe and trust that because I'm saved now, then I'm good to go. Not understanding there's going to be a time where church is not what it used to be, and the enemy knocks on your door. There's going to be a time, Tierra, where the pastor is not the same guy he used to be. There's going to be a time where the people that you loved and you fell in love with that spoke to you are not the same people that they used to be. You know why? Because we get tired too. And sometimes when we get tired, we stop speaking. Sometimes when we get tired, we stop loving the way we used to love. And it's not intentional. It's just that we have bad days too. And then now we start saying, well, that may not be for me. But what has happened is we failed to evolve, and what we depended on was the cross. And now we don't even want to see the cross because we need some Holy Spirit. But we were trusting on the blood, and now all of a sudden what we were trusting in is not there because we tired too. All of us, you know, I asked them how long they've been. Y'all had just made it here when y'all got married. Huh? 10 years. We've been together 10 years. We've been in this marriage 10 years. We've been in this relationship 10 years. Guess what? We don't like each other all the time. Right? We don't like each other all the time. Right? I don't answer the call. I don't text back quick as I used to, right? It puzzles you, right? Huh? Okay, yeah, it does. You're like, whoa, Pastor. Why are you? She'd be like, why he respond? But it happens, right? Give time, and then time want to talk forever. I'd be like, look here, man. You got time. I got a life. But watch this. But watch this. When I text her and she don't answer. Hold on, what's going on with her? It works both ways. But what I'm saying is, sometimes we have these honeymoon experiences with church. We have these honeymoon experiences with church. And now that the thrill is gone, we don't want to be in love anymore. Miss Jan and Mr. Bill will be married 30 plus years in October. It's August. Oh, her birthday is in October. Yeah. I knew it was in August, right? I know. Watch this. Every day ain't a honeymoon, I bet. Every day ain't a honeymoon. Sometimes I want to go grab that bag by myself and get, you see what I'm saying? But watch this, 30 years they have hung in there. Amen. 30 years they say, no, we may be here, but we gonna get there together. But what happens is, if we don't evolve our mindset, we'll end up quitting destiny prematurely. And watch this. If we look at this text today, 1 Kings chapter 17, and when I looked at this, I was like, bro, like God, this is a little different. And I almost didn't want to minister it, but God showed me something here. If you look at 1 Kings chapter 17, the Bible says that, oh, give me one second, there we go. It says, there is not much that we know about Elijah in the text. Now, Elijah is one of the most prolific people in the Bible by the work that he did. He does, amen. But when he first come on the scene, when the Bible brings him on, there is not a lot we know about him. And actually, once we start reading his story, there is not much that the Bible says about him. But the work that he does is so powerful, amen, for the evolution of what we know as ministry, as kingdom. When God introduces him, he introduces him along his journey. The Bible, amen, actually, Elijah's story actually opens up when Israel is transitioning in kingship from King Amari, amen, to King Ahab, which is Amari's son. Watch this. I'm sorry. In order to understand Elijah's journey, you must first understand King Ahab. Well, point number one. Sometimes your story is linked to your enemy. Sometimes your story is linked to what almost took you out. The other tab, you caught that? Sometimes what tried to kill you is what you got to go and prophesy to. Watch this. And Elijah's story is linked to Ahab. The Bible actually describes Ahab as one of the kings who, as the king who did more evil in the sight of God than any other king before him. So here God goes talking about Ahab and how Ahab is promoted to king and Ahab's lineage to the family, to his family. And then he brings Elijah on scene. The Bible says in verse 33 of 1 Kings chapter 16, Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger. Ahab did more to provoke the Lord God of Israel to anger than all the kings of Israel who are before him. Then he brings Elijah on. So God says, Ahab has made me mad. Now here come Elijah the Tishbite. What if that was you? God said, Yolanda, Ahab don't have favor with me, so I need you to show up. Can you imagine the pressure of the call that's on your life when God has called you to do something great with one of the most dangerous people that he ever encountered? One of the most evil people that he have ever encountered. See, some of y'all are running from evil stuff when God called you to it. And many of us have been running from destiny. We've been running from destiny because we don't want to tolerate what we consider nonsense. And God is saying the nonsense is what's going to make you. Watch this. And when God brings him on scene, because just like y'all, this is what I see in Elijah. Some of y'all say, I don't know if I can do that. I don't know if I'm ready for that. I don't know if I'm the one. She in the back shaking her head. I don't know if I'm the one. But watch this, Elder Jabari. The Bible describes Elijah as Elijah, the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Galilee. He has no formal introduction. He has no formal background. He is not a warrior like Joshua. He didn't kill lions, tigers, and bears like David. He wasn't prepared to face what he faced. Some interpreters actually, amen, they interpret his title as a stranger. So Elijah is really unknown to everybody around. Nobody knows him. Nobody understands him. He's not equipped. He's not prepared. He don't have the tools it takes, but God sends him to speak to the king. Could you be downplaying your position because when you look in the mirror, you don't see nothing, but God sees everything? And what we have to understand is this. God don't call the qualify. He qualifies the call. But we've been sitting down on our gifts. We've been sitting down on our blessings because every time we look in the mirror, we see something that's unknown. And God say, But it's time for you to go from here to there. Hey, you've been unknown, but God knows you. The world hadn't seen you, but God knows you, amen. The world hadn't accepted you, but God knows you. Everybody looking at you crazy, like where you come from, who you think you are, but God knows you, amen. You didn't ask to go there, but God say it's time to go where? From here. To there. The Bible says, amen, that even though Elijah is unknown, God gives him a prophetic voice to speak into the life of a king who is defiling the seat of leadership over God's people. So Elijah says to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew or rain these years except at my word. People of God, can you imagine being in a position to where God calls you to shut everything down? God calls you to restructure everything. God calls you to tell the people, like, look here, if we don't get it right in this season of our lives, then we may not never get it right. And until we get it right, this is the drought that we're going to have. Could you imagine being that voice to where somebody have the gall like Ahab to build an altar? He's God's king. He's assigned to Israel. But here he is building an altar for a whole nother god named Baal. And God sends Elijah, who nobody knows, to the king to say, I'm about to shut it down.
Elijah's journey, Jabari took him into a place that he didn't understand. And people of God, sometimes God will pull us in a place that we don't understand to assist him, so to assist it so it won't fall. To assist it so it won't fall. Can I be honest with y'all? The reason why God got me teaching that on Wednesday night, because some of y'all, he's called here to assist so we won't fall, that you haven't realized that you the person, that you the one. Y'all, do y'all understand? And I am humble enough to say this. We can be great when you become great. I'm humble enough to say this, that this ministry, the greatness of this ministry is not in me. It is not in her. The greatness of this ministry is in some people that's sitting out in the pews right now who refuse to be Elijahs. Who refuse to be Elijahs, but rather sit there and say, I don't know if I have what it takes. I don't know if I have what it takes. And God is calling some Elijahs in this season to partner with us, amen, to become a part of this ministry, to team with us, to take us to a greater level. And that don't mean you're a pastor. That does not mean you're an apostle. But that means that there is something in you that God wants to use. And God is calling me in this season to pull it out of you and say, let's run with it. Let's run with it. Because in this season of your life, you can't stay here. You can't stay here, Yolanda. You've been here too long. You can't stay here, Vicky. You've been here too long. You've been here too long. And Frost, you messed up and married one that's been there too long. So guess what? You gotta go too. I know it's tiring. I know it's frustrating. I know all of this, but see, that's why we got to be careful who we get married to. Because some of us are married to people with oil on their lives. Some of us are married with people with oil, with real oil on their lives. And we think we just going to be cooling out, having fun. And we're going to look cute together, and we're going to smile, and yeah, we're going to, yeah. Not understanding, it's time to go from here to there. Reggie and Al Tamisa, I hate to tell you. I hate to tell you, but that's some oil in that marriage. That's some oil. That boy's had oil on him for a long time. That boy's had some oil on him. I don't mean to call you no boy. I don't mean no disrespect. That guy's had some oil on him for a long time, Miss Jane, a good dude. It don't get no better than Reginald Connor. The heart don't get no better than him. He almost reminds me of Ramiah. Don't say much, but I wouldn't cross him. Don't say much, but I wouldn't cross him. But then Al Tamisa, I found out, amen, that you were super, 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 super smart. See, sometimes, you can go back. Sometimes we can come be a part of something. I'm actually done preaching. Sometimes we can actually be a part of something. And I didn't even get through, but God say stop. Sometimes we can come and be a part of something, not understanding that there's a mandate. There's a mandate. And the oil ain't him. The oil ain't him. He just got the knowledge behind it. He knows where to find it, but the oil is on you. I'll be honest to say, the oil ain't on me. I just got the know-how. The oil is in the house, and it's always been there, but it ain't me. And see, sometimes people of God will say, I know you been in the wilderness. I know you've been in the wilderness, and I know you knowing that there is more, but no one takes the time to really sit down and be like, man, do you not know what's in you? Do you not know what's in you? Do you not know what's in you? Look looking at you by the wall down there. I'm looking past them right now. Do you not know what's in you? Do you not know the oil that's on your life that can change generations? Brothers, y'all don't know how blessed y'all are to have a man under your roof like that. I know it's crazy. I know it's not under, but that's a dude right there. That's a man's man. I know you feel like you haven't been seen, but there is more in you. GB, won't it change for you if you just position yourself? You can't stay here in that place to where you limit yourself. Here is a mindset. Here is a way of thinking. Because didn't nobody know you. Vicky, I know you like the background, but God didn't call you to the background. Someone approached me the other day about you. Say, hey, I just got through talking to Vicky. I said, hold my tiller. She said, you what? I said, yeah, I call her my tiller. She's like, oh, and she had me explain to her, and I explained. She said, oh, yeah. But God didn't call us to be nothing. God didn't call us to be routine. God did not call us to be. We don't do this every once, twice a week for no reason. We did this so we can change lives. Frost! Actually, we got one right over there now. Look at the Lord. We got one right over there right now in a storage yard that hadn't been driven for 3 years. We got one right over there in the storage yard that hadn't been driven for 3 years. But you driving, making money for somebody. Talk to Reggie and Altamise. They drive 18-wheelers. You got buses. Could we have the bus company and the tow company? Y'all mess up, make me start thinking. This is. Could we, Tiffany? While we out looking for jobs from other people, can't we hire some folk? We gotta move from here to there, y'all. I don't care if we like Elijah and nobody knows our name. We can speak to Ahab and tell him we gonna lock this thing up if we don't get it right. At my voice. Because see what happens with Elijah. Elijah speaks to Ahab. Then God tells him to go to the brook of Cherith. And when you at the brook of Cherith, then I'm going to provide provisions from you from the ravens and the brook. Why? Because God is telling Elijah, I'm going to give you protection and provision that you need. I'm going to give you the protection and the provision that you need just to do what I told you to do. If you do what I told you to do. So when we do what God tells us to do, he's going to give us the protection and the provision that we need. And watch this. Along the way, God is going to give us assignments like the widow woman. Amen. He's going to give us assignments like the widow woman. Amen. Who's down to her last. Who's about to commit suicide. In her mind, she's about to commit suicide because she and her son is going to eat her last. They're going to eat their last little bit and they're going to die. They got a suicide mentality on them. Which means God is going to send us people who are spiritually dead in order to revive. In order to revive, watch this. And then we're going to revive. We're going to be able to revive people who's going to be miracles. Your barrel.
keep in motion, Yolanda. We're going to be able to stand before the prophets. We stood before one prophet, but now we're going to be able to stand before armies of prophets and be able to proclaim what thus said the Lord. But we can't do it here. We can't do it here. We can't be a giant and playing million positions. So today, y'all, ask yourself this. Who am I? Ask yourself this. Who am I? Who are you?
So fresh, so clean, because of that man. He bled and died and gave me life again. I mean, life began because I was sinking down to the pit. That's where I was heading. My ultimate purpose and evident and sacrifice. Thank you, thank you, thank you for tremendously saving my life. You saved my life. Yup, 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 you saved my life.